upper will drop out. It's all right. We cannot unite with such people. But Ruth will say, get me to the land of promise. Get me to the land of consecration. And get me to the land of the people of God. The land of the world. I'm going back with you. And it is such a person you can unite with. And when you unite with such people, great will be what will happen in our lives, in our church, in Jesus' name. Unity like that of Ruth and Naomi. I'm looking at Esther chapter 4. Esther chapter 4. I'm reading from verse 15 all through to verse 17. Esther, we're looking at chapter 4. The unity we're talking about, you see, we have examples in the Bible. Here we read of Mordecai and Esther. Mordecai and Esther. And you see, it was a costly thing here. The kind of faith that can bring deliverance for a whole nation. Because the Jews at this time, what had happened is, because Mordecai was an uncompromising man, because of that, Haman said, I'm going to destroy all the Jews. And the cry went out in Shushan, and everywhere, destruction has come. They're going to terminate our existence. And if they kill us now, how will the Messiah come? They want to kill all the Jews. And then there were two people, one a man, the other one a woman, one Mordecai, the other one Esther. The kind of unity that is going to save a nation. The kind of unity that is going to save our continent. The kind of unity that is going to bring the power of God to bear on this whole land is that kind of unity of one mind, of one vision, of one dream, of one passion, of one principle, of one drive, of one goal that you'll find between Mordecai and Esther. Esther chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 15. It says, then Esther bade them return Mordecai this answer. Go, gather together all the Jews that are present in Shushan, and fast ye for me, and neither eat nor drink, nor drink 3 days, night or day. I also and my maidens will fast likewise, and so will I go in unto the king, which is not according to the law. And tell me the rest. Read it out loud. And if I perish, I perish. That's the kind of unity that I count the cost. I lay my life on the line. You know, there are some people, they'll be united. Once there's no slander, once there's no threat, they'll be united. Once there's no Haman that threatens our existence, they'll be united. While there is no challenge, there's no persecution of the church, where there's no persecution of the Jews. Oh, we're united. Mordecai, I'm with you. Esther, I'm with you. But you see, this is the kind of unity that says, if I perish, I perish. I count the cost. And I put my Lord with the people of God. So this Esther said, go tell Mordecai, and you tell him, you fast for me, and I will fast likewise. And something that is not according to the law of the land where we are, I'm going to do that naturally. I'm putting my life in jeopardy and in danger, but in unity of faith to preserve the Jewish people and to preserve the nation of the Jews, so that the Messiah Christ will come through the Jews later. That's why I'm going to do this. And when you understand, the hope of this nation is a church like this. The hope of this continent is a church like this. The hope of the salvation of multitudes, millions, is a church like this, that will stand on the whole Bible from cover to cover, and we dot every I and we cross every T, and we say, thus says the Lord, and we're not willing to deviate or change. This is the hope of the land and the hope of the rapturable church. This is the kind of church. And when you understand that, because of that future and because of Christ be presented unto the nations of the world, you say, if I perish, I perish. I'm united. That's the kind of unity that will save the land. And I pray that that unity will be in our midst in Jesus' name. I said, to be in our midst in Jesus' name. You are not going to say, well, Haman is in power, and because Haman is in power, has authority, and the king Ahasuerus has given him a signet of assurance and authority and of, you know, whatever, he is the one that has the word of decree and the word of power now. Therefore I switch away from Mordecai and Esther, and then I'm going to Haman. Never. It will not happen in your life in Jesus' name. And you know, if we unite together, you will see that as we unite in faith and unite on the word of God, all of Haman, you'll so forget Haman in Jesus' name. All those enemies of righteousness, enemies of the people of God, we're going to forget them forever in Jesus' name. I'm looking now at Acts of the Apostles chapter 16. Acts of the Apostles chapter 16. And I'm reading here from verse 25. The unity we're talking about, the kind of unity you'll find between Paul and Silas. Paul and Silas, they went out with the commission to preach the word of God. And then there was a damsel. We're having the spirit of divination and saying, these are the servants of the Most High God who showed to us the way of salvation. And then when that was said, eventually Paul the apostle said, I command thee, evil spirit, in the name of Jesus, come out of her. And it came out immediately. And the people that were gaining something out of the spirit of divination, because they turned it to its business, they were angry with that. And then they put Paul and Silas in jail. But Silas did not say, Paul, see where we are now. See where you brought us to. If you had left that woman alone, if you left that maid alone, we will not be here. There was no disagreement. There was no discord. There was no dissenting voice. They were united together. On the preaching evangelistic field, they were united together. In the prayer meeting, they were united together. Under persecution, in the pain of imprisonment, they were united together. That's the kind of unity that will make faith to come alive, that will make faith to work, that will make faith to the explosive power it ought to have, that no matter what is happening, they looked at Paul, they said he was a prisoner. And then they looked at Silas, they said he has become a prisoner. And Paul was not ashamed of Silas. Silas was not ashamed of Paul. And it is in that kind of unity, when you identify with your brother's suffering, you identify with your sister under persecution, it is that kind of unity that will bring the explosive power of the Lord. Look at it. Acts of the Apostles chapter 16. I'm reading from verse 25. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed, and they sang praises unto God. And the prisoners heard them. And suddenly, it will happen again. I said it will happen again. You see, this is the kind of unity we're talking about. There's some people, when the going's, you know, easy, they're united. But when the going gets tough, when the challenges are great, and when it appears the pain is unbearable, that's the kind of unity, that's the time the Lord is calling his people to unity. And when you have this kind of unity in the prison with Paul and Silas, suddenly something will happen. I said suddenly something will happen. That's why it says, and suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison, they were shaking, and immediately all the doors were open and everyone's bands were loosed. Every mountain will move away and everyone's bands will be loosed in Jesus' name. The mountain moving power of united, unspotted conquerors. Point number three now, the miracle working power in a united, unmovable congregation. The miracle working power in a united, unmovable congregation. United, unmovable congregation. United, unmovable congregation. What we call church is a congregation. Church in the Greek language is ecclesia. It's made of two words, called out assembly. The people who are called out, they're called out of sin. They're called out of the society. They're called out of the systems of the world. They're called out of all the various places, some from Greek area, some from Hebrews area, some are Grecians and some are Hebrews, some are Hellenists and some are Palestinians, and they call them out, and they come from every tribe, and they come from every clan, and they come from every nation, and they come to form one body, one church, one congregation. And such a congregation, united, unmovable, those are the people that in the unity of their faith, recognizing themselves as the family of faith and the family of faithful people, those are the people that are going to have the covenant of the Lord. Let's look at Psalm 89. I'm reading from verse 5. Psalm 89 verse 5. Immovable congregation. Psalm 89, and I'm reading here from verse 5. 89 verse 5. A congregation, an assembly, a church of real Christians and real conquerors, consecrated, committed people. Psalm 89 verse 5. It says in verse 5, and the heavens shall praise thy wonders, O Lord, thy faithfulness also in the congregation of the saints. In the congregation of the saints, not congregation of sinners, not congregation of backsliders, not congregation of religious people, not congregation of denominational people, not a congregation of wishy-washy people, worldly-minded people, in the congregation of saints. And these are the people, look at their language, look at their language. I'm looking at Psalm 57. In Psalm 57, look at the language of this kind of congregation. Psalm 57, I'm reading here from verse 7. My heart is fixed to God. My heart is fixed. These are the people. The winds may blow, the storm may come, the waves may beat against their boat, but they say, my heart is fixed on God. My heart is fixed. My heart is fixed on God. My heart is fixed on my Savior, my Deliverer, my Fortress. My heart is fixed on my Redeemer. My heart is fixed on heaven. My heart is fixed on your word. My heart is fixed on God. My heart is fixed. That's the congregation we're talking about. Look at Psalm 108, and here it tells us once again what the Lord is saying about such people. And you will see that these are the people, they have a mind that stays with the Lord, a mind that is fixed on the Lord. Psalm 108, in Psalm 108 verse 1, O God, my heart is fixed. O God, my heart is fixed. There is no wavering in their commitment to Christ. And there is no dilly-dallying of fear or being frightened in the commitment of their faith. They are centered on Christ and they are settled on Christ. We're looking at Psalm 112, Psalm 112, and I'm reading here from verse 7. He shall not be afraid of evil tidings. His heart is fixed. His heart is fixed. His heart is fixed. That's the congregation we're talking about. The congregation that is steadfast and stable and solid, settled on the word of the Lord. And those are the people that you can trust, that you can depend on. There will be miracle working power in their midst. And as you believe in Christ and you say, oh Lord, I believe you are my Christ, you are my Savior, you are my Master, you are my Messiah, you died for me, you shed your blood for me, and I pledge my whole life on Calvary, I pledge my whole life on you, and my heart is fixed, there will be nothing that will shake me out of my conviction. That's the kind of congregation that in these last days the Lord will use, and He will do exploits in the name of the Lord. Let me come to Acts of the Apostles chapter 4. Acts of the Apostles chapter 4, and we're reading from verse 23. Acts of the Apostles chapter 4, we're looking at verse 23. Acts chapter 4, verse 23. Since Jesus went to heaven, these disciples, a church of the faithful, the church of the saved, the church of the sanctified, and the church of the committed, the church of the consecrated, they were looking towards heaven. And they knew that any time Christ will come. And because of that, nothing shook them, nothing bothered them. They know, my heart is fixed on my goal. Here is my goal. Here is the way to go. And because they are part of such a congregation, unwavering, immovable, and unspotted, then you understand that's why they were so united. Acts chapter 4, reading from verse 23. So, and being let go, they went their way, they went to their own company, that's the congregation, and they reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said unto them. And when they had this, they lifted up their voice to God with one accord. They lifted up their voice to God with one accord, and they said, Lord, thou art God, which has made heaven and the earth and the sea and all that in them is. And then they continue their prayer, verse 31, and with great, verse 31, and when they had prayed, the place was shaking where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness. Supernatural boldness will come in the heart of everyone again in Jesus' name. Give me a good amen there. Acts of the Apostles chapter 12, miracle working power of in a united, immovable church. Miracle working power in a united, immovable church. We're looking at Acts chapter 12. Acts chapter 12, verse 5. It says in verse 5, Peter therefore was kept in prison, and prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. Look at that. Peter therefore was kept in prison, and nobody said, everybody will bear his own body. Let Peter carry his own cross. Let Peter bear his own body. Let Peter get the consequence of whatever happened, that now they put him in prison. And then it says, but prayer was made of the church, the whole congregation, fixed and settled on the word of God, and having the same purpose and the same mind and the same vision and the same goal, wanting to get to heaven. Our goal in this church is heaven. I said our goal in this church is heaven. The Lord has gone to prepare a place for us in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, so that where I am, there ye will be also. We're expecting that the heavens will open at any time. And when the heavens open, then He will come. He will take us home in Jesus' name. Because I show you, Israel shall not all die. Because in the twinkle of an eye, the trumpet shall sound. And then he says, those who are dead, they'll rise up, and we which are alive will be caught up together with them in the clouds in the air. So comfort ye one another with these words, the Lord is coming. And because our hope is heaven, our goal is heaven, our mind is in heaven. That's why we're looking for him. And it says over here, the whole congregation, they then began to pray. What was the answer of that? Because of that unity, because of that cohesiveness, and because of that immovability, they were immovable.